We're about to begin. This is a book launch, Hybrid Tapestries, The Development of Pakistani Literature in English by Muneeza Shamsie. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them on silent mode. We would appreciate it if complete silence is observed while the performance is in progress. Our moderator for the session is Dr. Tariq Rahman. Presently based at Lahore, Dr. Tariq Rahman is an eminent scholar and academician. He is presently working as Dean, School of Liberal Arts and Social Sciences, and Acting Dean, School of Education, Beacon House National University, Lahore. Yes, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here. This is going to be a session like all others. But let me tell you this also, this is a session which ought to make history, because such a book has not come out in the history of the literature written in English in this country. This is Muneeza Shamsie's Hybrid Tapestries.
Well, I'm a bit overwhelmed by that. I have to interrupt and say thank you and thank you again.
Well, okay, let us begin with this panel. So on the extreme left, Aroosa Kanwal. She's an assistant professor in English literature in the International Islamic University. And she received a PhD from Lancaster University in the UK. Her book is Rethinking Identities in Contemporary Pakistani Fiction Beyond 9/11. There are many other things written over there. If you can read them over there, what is interesting is she has written a book on fiction 2015, which is perhaps the latest on that. Of course, this book comes after that, but this one is concentrated only on fiction. Because I will begin with that, that is one point which I want you to note. And the next one, we normally say she doesn't, nobody needs an introduction. She really does not. She has been Navid, Shahzad. She's been an actor, a poet, a journalist, TV pioneer. She has taught English literature in the Punjab University. And she was at Beacon House too, where I am nowadays, in the School of Liberal Arts, and she was a dean over there. At the moment, I really don't fit her shoes at all, but I'm supposed to be dean over there at the moment. What is interesting, again, is that she has the latest being a performance of an Urdu translation of Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew. Now, Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew, for those who have enjoyed it, etc., in English, what a treat it would be in Urdu, where we try to tame everyone, shrew or otherwise. So because again I'm going to ask her a question relating to this, I have I mentioned this book. And of course the author, Muneeza Shamsie, I've known her for a long time, and she has been writing on Pakistani literature in English from the time I have known her, which is, I think, more than 30 years now. So
Something like that, yes.
I suppose so. And she has been on, you know, she has written in the, contributed earlier to the Oxford Companion of the, Oxford Companion of the Literatures of Pakistan, three anthologies of Pakistani English literature, won two independent publisher awards in the US and the American edition of And the World Changed Contemporary Stories by Pakistani Women. She served on the International Advisory Board of the Journal of Postcolonial Writing. She has guest edited two special issues, Al Andalus and Beyond Geography, Literature, Politics and Violence in Pakistan. And of course, she writes the section on bibliography for the Journal of Commonwealth Literature. She has been on the DSC Prize for South Asian Literature, and she was jury over there. So in case there are young writers over here, she's the person to look for. She is obviously a very difficult person to follow, because someone who writes a book this big and you know, so competently is obviously a person who spends a lot of time on reading and writing. So those young people who want to talk to her, etc., should at the same time concentrate more on the same kind of reading and writing, and of course they will one day get there. Because if this book is there, we've got faith in the future. I'll then begin with, let me also tell you how I intend to do it, and the panelists agree with me. There are three major parts of the ongoing exercise. The first one is that I'm going to ask questions to the panelists, individual questions, and in the second 20 minutes I'll ask one or two common questions to all, and the third one I'll try to open it to all of you, because I know you're going to contribute to it as much as we do, perhaps more. So let me now begin with the questions, the first part. Dr. Aroosa, you have written a book on fiction, as I just said. What do you think, keeping this book in mind, and this has got everything from the beginning to now, so what do you think of the trends on Pakistani fiction in English, before 9/11, after 9/11, whichever you want to concentrate upon, but what do you think are the trends?
Thank you so much, Dr. Rahman. Yes, of course, you know, I mean, those who have actually read the book will understand the complexity that is to be found with reference to the Pakistani Anglophone literary tradition. I think, again, if you just look at Pakistani literature in general, or fiction in particular, you will feel this thing that, you know, there is a diversity of themes and yawns, you know, with reference to this particular trajectory. If you just go back to, you know, the writers of the first generation writers, for example, you say that, you know, we have a clear category of the of 1947 fiction, you know, that includes the writers such as Bapsi Sidwa and Abdullah Hussain and Anif Qureshi, and then, you know, we have the writers again, you know, who are writing about the post-independence problem. Then there are writers who have been talking about 1971 legacy. So we have these clear categories, you know, of the Pakistani fiction when it comes to the first generation. But then when we move towards the second generation writers, again, you will feel this thing that the writers again are writing about, of course, you know, there is a huge category which is usually termed as the post 9/11 fiction, where writers have actually focused on the events of the 9/11 and the repercussions of 9/11 on the lives of the Muslims, not only at home but also in the diaspora. But other than this huge category where we were writing in response to the Western mainstream Western discourses, right, based on a war on terror or Islamophobia debates, etc., there are writers who are still focusing on indigenous problems, and of course the names of Muhammad Hanif and Mohsen Hamid and Daniel Moyuddin, Bina Shah. I mean, all these writers are actually focusing on the, you know, on diverse problems that you can see that people are facing. I mean, that includes minority issues, that includes women rights debates, the problems associated with the, I mean, again, the eco-critical issues, the patriarchal tendencies, Islamic conservatism within the Muslim world, within Pakistan, and of course in the other Muslim world. And then of course, the debate goes beyond that too. Okay. So we just cannot say that we have a limited category of fiction, but rather this is a rich trajectory where people are experimenting not only with the themes but also with the forms as well. And of right. course, the most significant name is that of Bilal Tanvir right. and you know, Maha Phillips Khan and Amir Hussain, who are experimenting with the form, writing in the Gothic okay. traditions as well.
Okay. I would like to welcome our fourth panelist, Dr. Waqas Khwaja, who is also an English language poet. He writes in the English language, poetry in the English language. At the moment, he's in the US, and I'm very grateful that you're here today. Of course, in his case, I will ask him to speak about the poetry of Pakistan, but a little later. Meanwhile, just on the same issue, is there anything specific which you would like to point out in fiction which may be called political short story or political novel about 1971 or about something else, about the about Karachi or about the violence going on in Pakistan, anything?
I think
which you would like to concentrate.
All literature have been political in one way or the other. Yes. I mean, like, you know, if you just talk about 1947 again, there are writers who are coming up with multiple narratives. They are trying to
just
deconstruct.
One great work, which in your eyes, one very major work, which has actually moved you.
I mean, for example, you know, Bapsi Sidwa's, you know.
Right.
Right. Novel
right.
Is Ice Candy Man, for example.
Yes.
Exactly.
Okay.
That
right.
is based on 1947.
Okay.
And then Daniel Moyadeen's, of course, short stories, which are written against, you know, against this is the rise of Islamic extremism and the patriarchal tendencies within Pakistan. And then Karachi novels, written by Kamila Shamsie or Muhammad Hanif, I think.
Even Uzma Aslam Khan.
Uzma Aslam Khan, particularly. The Geometry of God, and then the Broken Verses.
The purpose of the question was to see, because there is one paradigmatic work, that's what I wanted to know. So in that case, you mentioned Babsi Sidwa first.
Yes.
Take it from you there. Navid Shahzad Sahib, please tell me about, you have staged this play in Urdu. First, why in Urdu? And secondly, why is there so little drama in English? From not from 47 but earlier also in English there's very little of it, or why so little?
Thank you, Dr. Rahman. Well, there's a very interesting background to the fact that we produced, my company Theatre Wale produced Taming of the Shrew in Urdu. This was part of the whole scheme which was launched by the Globe Theatre in London. And it was a sort of subsidiary activity during the Olympics in London. Every country had to produce Shakespeare in their own language.
I see. Okay.
We had to do it in Urdu. It wasn't easy. We were three writers. I was in Lahore, and there was another writer who was sitting in London, and yet another who was sitting in the US. So we were continually talking to each other, as it were, translating, looking at things and so on, and reworking and working through it. I don't claim to be an authority at translating Shakespeare at all. I do not mean to say that he cannot be translated. Of course he can.
Yes.
The situation within Taming of the Shrew lent itself very well to the situation in Pakistan. All about patriarchy, all about the sharp-tongued woman, the shrew, whether she could get married or not, and so on. What are the qualities that a woman should have were she to attract the most attractive suitor, and so on. So there were lots of reasons why we selected this particular play.
Right. And why the second part of the question, why do we have so little of English theatre?
Well, I don't know if you can isolate English theatre and say why so little of it. I'd like to take you back to the time that we're looking at theatre per se, and we have a very long legacy of that. A lot of our writers are writing in Urdu. There's a lot of theatre. The very first truly structured Urdu drama is Imtiaz Ali Taj's Anarkali. And from that you start to get the structured drama.
Agha Hashar also, well, in Parsi theatre, but why is so little in
Agha
English?
Hashar, I'm sorry, the Parsi theatre doesn't really lend itself to Agha Hashar. Parsi theatre is an entity in itself. It's a post-colonial and a colonial issue that we're talking about. There's a problem with writing in English in the dramatic form.
I see.
The issue is that of dialogue. How not to sound stilted. You don't sound stilted at all in poetry. I have to pay a very special compliment to Khwaja Sahib, whom I have read with great pleasure and continue to read, and so on. I think we lent ourselves to the poetic form far earlier and far more easily than even to fiction. Fiction came much later.
Yes.
So it's a genre by choice.
I see.
And drama, because of its complexity and because of a lack of understanding of theatre per se as a performance, I think writers just didn't take to it very well. Because we had such fine writing in Urdu, we didn't really feel the need for the English theatre. We were using a hybrid form all the time. We were using translated plays.
I
mean, all the comedies that the Arts Council produced in Lahore, they were all, Charlie's aunt became Khalid ki khala and things like that.
Yes.
So, you know, and the stalwarts and the pioneers for that were Naeem Tahir and his wife Yasmin Imtiaz and Shweb Hashmi and Salima Hashmi, Atiya Khayyam and all these people who started the whole focus on theatre per se. But it was a hybrid theatre.
I see.
So it's okay. It's not that people didn't write anything in English as far as the dramatic form is concerned. We've got some very fine plays now. Mm. We've got Akbar S. Ahmed, we've got Shahid Mahmood Nadeem, who's translated his own work into English. Mm. So there is a corpus of theatre,
yes,
English writing in theatre, which is starting to emerge.
Okay.
But it's right. The latest of the genres that we are right. already right. talking about.
But as we know, we've had a lot of English poetry, of course, and you being a poet, can you tell us, especially with the reference to this book, but even otherwise, what do you think are the distinguishing trends or themes of poetry in English written in Pakistan?
Yeah, again, poetry too, being one of the oldest forms that
yes.
is being used for creative expression, does have a whole lot of diversity of themes in it. I will say this also, that this is enormous work that Muneeza Shamsie has done, because it covers the entire sort of span of from the time of Pakistan to the present day of the writers. And it's not just the past writers and the writers writing in the middle period, but contemporary writers also that are included. But I must also at the same time say this is the first of those works, or the second of those works, because you did the first work, I remember that, years ago.
Well, that's a history, and this is a development of.
Right.
Yes.
So
right.
there's a slight change in focus.
I agree with that too. That is very well said, because this actually traces the evolution, if you will. The one thing that I would want to see, however, is now moving out of the chronological order, and then relating works across the various spans that we are talking about, time spans that we are talking
right.
of. Because then we'll see thematic resonances, we'll see how the aesthetics has changed, the forms have changed. We'll also see how the thinking has evolved as well. And in many ways, it may be very insightful, it may be very sort of illuminating for us in this regard, that we may begin to see the emergence of a distinctive Pakistani voice, if I may say that.
Tawfiq Rafat's Pakistani idiom, sir. Right.
Well, it started
yeah.
very well from that, but
yes.
you know, it has evolved too.
Yeah.
I'm very allergic to this idea of the Pakistani idiom. We talk in terms of Pakistani English as though it were a form by itself. Nobody talks about Indian English. I mean, you just happen to be an Indian who's using English as a medium. We are Pakistanis who happen to choose the medium that we write in a language that may not be our mother tongue.
Okay. Right.
I'm afraid, you know, I'll have to disagree with you. Much that I respect not only your immense intelligence and learning and your experience, but also your judgment. I am saying that in all seriousness,
okay.
by the way.
Dr. Sir,
the difference that I, the one thing yeah. that I'd like to, the difference yeah. is people do talk of Indian English.
Okay.
People do talk of Australian English.
Okay.
People do talk of Caribbean English.
No,
people
just
do talk
moment.
Of Irish English.
May I exercise now my, you know, I have to ask a question.
I'm
too.
Sorry,
now
Doc. You have to let me finish. No, this is much too interesting.
No, yes,
and
we'll get into this debate
if I may, just one moment.
We'll get into this
okay,
debate
Doc.
When I ask the general question.
Okay.
Now, I don't want to make it sound as an allegation.
It's not an
like
allegation.
No, to her.
Ah.
A Thana question.
Oh.
My question was, why did you write this book? Now, I will rephrase it. What
okay.
were the factors which you thought would be addressed in this book, which have not been addressed earlier, and which made you write this book?
Well, there were it's a bit of a long story about why I became interested in this literature anyway. I need to go back to that, and that I think will relate to this. The reason why I got interested in Pakistani English literature, or rather South Asian English literature, was because I was sent away to England to school at the age of 9, and I came back at 19. My only literature and my only language was English. In that literature, the only representations of my homeland were Kim, and there was Dr. Aziz, and that was it. There was no I was aware that there was another body of work that existed because my aunt, Atiya Hussein, had written a collection of short stories. And when I was at school, she also wrote Sunlight on a Broken Column. And my family was very proud of this. I came from a family where my mother's main language was Urdu and my father's main language was English. So I was aware of these, and hence the name, this hybrid tapestries, of these dual traditions. And what about my aunt? Because I was aware of her book, and we were very proud, my sister and I, and we went back to school and we kept talking about my aunt's book, and we kept talking about Sunlight on a Broken Column.
Yes.
And my teacher walked into the room and she said, "What is this book that you and your sister keep talking about? I've never heard of it." And that was it. That was the end of that discourse, any attempt to be proud or mention my aunt or that anyone wrote in English in my country, which was about the Jungle Book and about Dr. Aziz, you know, jumping up and down as far as I could see. Anyway, so I became very aware. So I started to look for this literature. And, you know, it comes into the my perceptions of how this literature was viewed and the kind of discourse that surrounded it. So then I come back to Pakistan at 19, in a country where I'm completely at sea and I don't know anything and I can't speak the language properly. And so then I start reading about it. So I start reading Ahmad Ali, I start reading Mumtaz Shahnawaz. The inevitable result of that was that then I started meeting people like Adrian Hussein, Salman Qureshi, then I started, I started attending poetry gatherings and discourses on Pakistani English literature long before I then leapt into journalism, and I had an editor who realized I loved reading and started sending me off to, there's this chap called Hanif Qureshi, he was all of 28, going off to interview Hanif Qureshi. One of the reasons for writing this book then was to pass on, because I felt I had seen this literature grow and develop, and then they became Babsi Sitwa. So one of the reasons was to actually pass on a kind of eyewitness account. Then, of course, the other thing was the last book that had been written was Tariq Rahman's, who had, when I read his book, by the way, he read a lot of very difficult books to read. And I thought, gosh, you know, he deserves a Victoria Cross for this, because the, you know, there were some, and some of them were very difficult to track down. And a lot of, you will find in this book, I've just sort of quoted, Tariq Rahman has discussed this, see Rahman, page 8, you know, because some of the books I couldn't find. And I discovered there was this tremendous need to write in English, to express yourself in English. And there were enormous technical problems involved. You know, in a way, writing in English about a culture which is not English, you're actually translating without translating. And it's a very difficult challenge. Other than that, what was your market? In Pakistan, there was a very small elite audience, which everybody kept saying, oh, they're so elitist and blah, blah, and no one was interested. And abroad, there was another limited audience. And this begins to, so I wanted to trace this. And the other thing that happened was because of my journalistic work, I was then, and because of my interest in reading and this genre, I was constantly interviewing writers who were coming, like people like Hanif Qureshi, then Rukhsana Ahmed came, I interviewed Hanif Qureshi, Rukhsana, then Amir Hussein. And I was actually in touch with Pakistani English literature. I was writing about it all the time. Everybody kept saying, well, the Indians are winning all the prizes, why isn't any Pakistani writing in English? And I could see that there was. And then after Tariq's book, which was 1990, there was actually nothing. There was no history. I did a couple of anthologies. So my actually reason for writing this book was A, to pass on the knowledge that I had or what I had witnessed, and B, to build up on Tariq's work and also that of Alamgir Hashmi, who had done some very valuable work. But what happened was, when I was writing this book, was that Pakistanis became immensely productive, and I started in 2005, and by the time I was, you know, we were getting, everybody was producing so much work that I actually had to say, well, you know, this is a cutoff date. So I then thought, okay, let's do the development up to the first decade of the new millennium. And I sort of brought it up to 2014, I did it in the last conclusion. And I hope that someone will then take the story forward from 2011. So I stopped at 2011 and discussing the books in detail. So that was really the trajectory and why I wrote it the way I did.
Great, and now it brings me to the general question. But I'll make it general questions because it's such an interesting debate. I'll begin with it.
Hooray!
When I was writing that book, there was this question of the Pakistani idiom. Tawfiq Griffith began it, I think. And of course, since then, there have been a lot of writing on Pakistani English, African English, Indian English, and so on. I myself have written a book called The Pakistani, but that's linguistic. By idiom, one means the way, is there a distinct treatment in, as far as you can read in this book, and in other books too, in Pakistani fiction, poetry, drama, essay, etc., which can be called Pakistani idiom or not? One question. Secondly, this book, do you think it adequately covers everything done till now, all the major trends, all the evolutionary, evolutionary levels, etc.? And is there any work to be done in future, not just in terms of chronological history, that of course, as years go on, people will write more, but in terms of the ways in which fiction, poetry, etc., is treated here and in books so far, or not? And we can begin with, I think the debate was ongoing, so I think we'll begin from the right this time.
Okay,
in any way the trend is towards the right.
I will start off and do the best I can here. I must make a distinction here between what we are talking of as the Pakistani idiom and what I mentioned as a distinct Pakistani voice.
Okay.
There is a basic difference between that, between these two terms. And it may be very true that there may be a distinct Pakistani English, Pakistani idiom, and linguistically, people who are very well qualified to do that, are specialists in that area, will be able to sort of look at that and point out the distinctions. But what I mean by a distinct Pakistani voice is the allusions, the references that you make in your writing, in your creative writing. What is the musée imaginaire that you have in your head? You know, what kind of connections do you make? What kind of metaphors do you make? What kind of similes do you make when you are doing what you call creative writing or imaginative writing? And you may not be consciously thinking of, you know, doing a particular kind of thing or the other. This is so much a part of who you are as a person living in the society that we call the Pakistani society, which is, by the way, not homogeneous in any way. It is a very diverse society. And it is a society that perhaps should be embraced in all its pluralism to understand, you know, the richness that it offers. So people coming from this part of the world, geographic part of the world, from this state, when they write, you're immediately able to actually pinpoint that when you read that. Whether it is fiction, whether it is the few plays that you see, or whether it is the poetry. And even if there are diasporic poets, you would see that in them.
Right.
So that's the distinction I think that we need to keep in mind between the Pakistani idiom and the distinct Pakistani voice. I'll just say one more thing. I do not believe at all that there should be any strictures about creativity, that you can do this kind of work or that kind of work and not another kind of work. So all power to people, by the way, who want to have their allusions in England, to English poets, British poets, or American poets, or European poets. That's all very fine. personally, I think that my sort of mindset is such that when I write imaginatively, I automatically seem to allude to a lot of references within our own culture and history, and deep history, I would say, so that we can go back into the Mahabharata, we can go back into the Indus Valley civilization, we can go back into the Jatak Kahanis, and a whole lot of other stuff that is part of the subcontinental culture. So I'm not saying this is the only way to write. I'm saying it is up to you to decide how you want to write. It is whatever moves you, whatever spirit moves you. But in the final analysis, even the imitative poets, even people, by the way, I don't mean that in a negative sense, people who are actually following in the footsteps of the great British tradition, even in their poetry, you would hear a very distinct voice that will sound Pakistani to you as opposed to Indian. Yeah. There's a distinction between the two. And again, you'll be able to pick it up if you read it. And I can perhaps identify some of the features, but again, this is a subject crying to be studied.
Right.
I couldn't agree with you more. So, aapne to pehle hi hathiyar dal diye, to ab main aur kya kahun?
That's fine. But please
my
go on.
The point that I was trying to make was that precisely what you have talked about, that there is a certain voice within the corpus of works that we look at, which is distinctly us. I give you one very clear example of that in Ulam Fariduddin Raz's Baramasa, which is a splendid piece of writing. He talks about how a thief has been caught in the village. I don't remember the exact lines, but in the vernacular, when you read that particular passage, it reads just like this. The man has been caught and he's being asked, tu pagal hai? Tu chori karda, tu sona chori karda. Tu chori karda, tu chandi chori karda. Tu chori karda, tu bail chori karda. Tu kharbuze chori kitan. So, this can only happen in this part of the world. And that really, to me, epitomizes exactly what you're talking about. When we talk about Tawfiq, for example, very few people know that he started off as a sports good manufacturer. And his verse, really, and I was fortunate enough to be mentored by him, his verse is really as tightly strung as his rackets were. So, you know, there is this very strong combination right from the time when somebody puts pen to paper. Where he comes from, that's where the voice takes him.
Right. Okay.
But before we go off onto this tangent, I would like to put in my halfpenny's worth. I think this is a monumental work, what Muneeza Shamsie has
absolutely
done. Not only because it's a magnum opus, it's a tome, but also because it carries forward what Dr. Tariq Rahman has already done, which is a seminal work. And this too, I would think, is a seminal work. My interest was aroused by the fact that it was called Hybrid Tapestries. Now for me, as a teacher of literature and so on, the one famous tapestry that is talked about in English literature is that of Penelope, Ulysses' wife, who puts together a tapestry in the morning and unravels it at night because she doesn't want to marry anybody else. For me, when I started to look through this book, it was really a labor of love, as women do, and these are creations of great art, when women thread skeins of colored silk through canvas in order to get to paint a picture. And this is what Muneeza Shamsie has done. She's taken up fiction, non-fiction, drama, poetry, journalism. I mean, you name it, it's all there.
Yes.
My one reservation is, of course, there are a few omissions, but really that's nitpicking.
Yeah.
I think it could have been edited a little better because there are repetitions. But then
yes,
that's really neither here nor there. I mean, you just look at the amount of work that has gone into it. My reservation about a work such as this, or a work such as Dr. Rahman's, or for example, the research work that my friend Fakir Ijazuddin does, is that the texts that they refer to are not accessible. And this to me is a very sad part of our study of how literatures evolve. There's a lot of Urdu literature that has gone missing. It's in Delhi or Lucknow or whatever, and if you have the means and you can go there and they're out of print and you can start looking for these texts, they're still available. Imtiaz Ali Taj did a wonderful job with his history of Urdu drama, and it's in volumes and so on. And I'm very much hoping that these two wonderful people sitting here are going to start some kind of a movement to start putting all these unknown texts together so that at least they are accessible to researchers, if not to the ordinary reader.
Well, thanks very much.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very good thing. But yeah. May I have your comments also?
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think we must, appreciate, Muneeza's effort, of digging all those archives, and gathering all that information and, putting them together in the form of a book. So I would say this is an expansive and indispensable reference book on Pakistani Anglophone literary tradition. Yeah. But for me, the most significant feature of this book is its focus on the writers that have received very little attention locally and globally. And probably it would not be wrong to say that many of us wouldn't even know those writers that were documented and that were actually recorded in this very book. And the same holds true for the first generation writer. For example, I didn't know that, one of the earliest dramatists, for example, of the subcontinent was Atiya Faizi. Yes. Or, similarly, when if you talk about, Sohrawardi's letters on the art subjects, or, the life, writing and the creative memoirs and the women's journalism by the writers of the first generation, they were never known to me. I mean, I was particularly working on the second generation writers. So I think this historical dimension of Muneeza's book is the most significant, thing in with reference to this book. I mean, the ways in which she is she's tracing the history of Anglophone literature from colonial to the modern times. And she is really setting the scene for the first and the second generation writers. And in so doing, these narratives, they claim a manifest or an implied congruence between the development of the literary tradition and the development of the nation. So, and again, very important thing that Muneeza does foreground the ways in which the literatures of the past or the literary tradition of the past is in dialogue with the contemporary situation. For example, when I was reading the book, I've come to know that Tawfiq Ruffat's translation of the Sufi poetry, particularly of the Bulleh Shah and of the Qadir Yar, kind of challenge, this idea of the fanatical and the highly politicized religious extremism of not only within Pakistan but also in the Muslim world in the last two decades, and which is our contemporary issue. Similarly, if you talk about the Daud Kamal's poetry, which is heavily influenced by the poetic Urdu poetic tradition or the Urdu poetic tradition. Exactly. I mean, this is something which is rebutting this whole discourse surrounding Pakistani Anglophone writing that, our writers rely to heavily on the Western, discursive enclosures, and they have failed to, avoid the trap of this self-exploitation for a global audience. I think all these myths have been kind of deconstructed when you look at this work. So hats off to Muneeza, for giving us this, not only the sense of history, but also emphasizing the fact that our writers need to connect to the past as well. The only thing which I found slightly problematic, I don't know, with reference to the writers that are discussed in this book, and particularly the first generation writers, because Muneeza has spent quite a lot of time discussing, and she has discussed these writers in separate chapters as well, that how do you situate these writers within the trajectory of Pakistani Anglophone writing, which again brings us to the same question of, you know, this Pakistani idiom. For example, I mean, I have a kind of a feeling that probably you are trying to put them or situate them within the trajectory of the larger Anglophone writers or Anglophone authors of the Muslim heritage, probably, because I don't know the writers that you're discussing at the beginning of the book, whether they are actually called Pakistani writers, because you have been describing them as Indian Muslim writers or Indian Muslim women writers, etc. So I would like you to sort of, you know, comment on that. And second very important thing that I remain confused, that's why I probably remain confused about the structure of the book, that, you know, that you haven't, for example, included Aslam within this group of the new generation of the writings over writing under the influence of the globalizing forces, 9/11, the geopolitics, etc., etc. And but you have included Abdullah Hussein, you know, among that group, you have bracketed them with the Bina Shah and Muhammad Hanif, etc., etc. So what was the reason? I mean, how did you structure the book? I mean, that, as a literary critic, I don't know, remains ambiguous to me.
And that, with this question, when you answer this question, I'll open to the audience. Because
okay, well, there are two things. There are a lot of things. One of the things is that how does a Pakistan comes into being in 1947, but these people were writing. We had Ahmad Ali who migrated, Atiya Faizi, Samuel Rahim, Surawardi. They were writing in English, but why on earth were they writing in English? So then I felt it was important. I didn't actually look at Muslim writers, because there are a lot of Muslim writers. I mean, for example, in Karachi, someone said, you've talked about Ahmad Ali and Surawardi, why haven't you talked about Atiya Hussein? I said, because Atiya Hussein did not migrate to Pakistan. I know she went to Britain. I've discussed diaspora writers, but Atiya Hussein, who I told you earlier was my aunt, was very firmly Indian. And she argued with this. We had, you know, the family had fiery arguments over whether they were Indian or Pakistani, and they used to chew each other up. So I don't actually discuss this with my Indian relatives, because the elders were completely out of control. My aunt was very firmly Indian, so I did not include her in this. But anyone who was an Indian Muslim who had migrated to Pakistan, I included, because I thought it was important to find out under what circumstances they were writing, and then what influence did that writing have or not have when they came here. And then, of course, once I started what circumstances in the 30s, then I had to ask, well, what circumstance, why was anybody writing in English anyway in the 30s or the 20s? And that took me back to colonial times, the whole colonial acquisition of English. So that was one aspect of it. Structuring, can I just finish?
Please.
The structuring of it became a little complicated, because I did want to have the first generation of writers to, I thought it was important to bring out, again, the circumstances under which this writing was forged, when there was actually nothing much happening around them. You know, there was a very, there was a lot of English language writing, but it was often archaic. And then you started getting writers in the diaspora, again, trying to forge a new voice, trying to identify their position in the diaspora. And so that was why I decided to place these 13 writers. Mm. That's from Atiya Faizi to Tariq Ali. Mm. In a separate section according to, as part one. And then in the second section, I kind of divided according to genre, because I thought then I should follow it that way.
May I just add to that? Yes. I think it's if you look at the book and you trace very clearly what you have done is movements.
Mm. Yes. Mm.
So I think if you look at it, rather than looking at it chronologically or in terms of partition and which particular country you went to, if you look at it as a movement,
yes,
then I think it makes much more sense.
Yes.
Okay, this is interesting, but unfortunately I'll have to go for questions and answers. Now, everyone, you know, it's, I don't say that you do not make a statement. Please do make a statement, but kindly keep it short. If you make it too long, I will be constrained to request you to cut it down at once. If I don't see a hand, please pardon me because I can't see all hands. So I can see this lady there and then, please go. Please go ahead, go ahead. Yes.
I just have one observation.
Nearer, please. Yes.
I just have one.
Close.
It's on.
It's on now. It's fine. Yes.
Yeah. The thing is that what I've noticed is that there hasn't been a lot of reference to literary criticism or theorization. This is specifically for you, Dr. Aroosa, at the same time. Why do you think that is so? Is that because we're not producing theories and criticism, or is that because there's a distance between the academia, the researchers, literary researchers, and the writers who are, you know, producing creative writing in different genres?
You're saying there's not enough criticism.
Yeah, and it hasn't been really encapsulated. I mean, there is criticism, but it hasn't been really encapsulated a lot in your work.
Well, I'll tell you, one of the issues in Pakistan has been that English language writing by Pakistanis, or even South Asian English literature, was actually not being taught here until recently, and it was in academia because it was about 10 years ago, at Karachi University, an academic came up to me and she said that she had been trying to introduce South Asian English writing, and the head of her department had been very disparaging, and he had said, oh, this is not literature, this is anthropology. And funnily enough, when I was researching the book, I remembered this remark, because around 1950 or so, someone had said this of Achebe's book, of Things Fall Apart, which is so famous now. And someone had said, a British critic had said, oh, this is not literature, this is anthropology. So obviously there was an old-fashioned literary criticism that was still being permeated. And in the last 10 or 15 years, it's really fantastic to see how South Asian English literature and Pakistan English literature has become part of our academia. And you will see, well, there's Aroosa who's done terrific work, and you've done terrific work, and it's all going to expand and grow. But we needed to have that modern discourse. The second point I want to raise is that when a literature is very new, when it's just being written, actually critical work appears many, many years later.
Yeah.
And one thing I would like to point out is because 9/11 is so topical, there have been lots of books on 9/11, yeah. And you know, a lot of people even think that all Pakistani English writers write on 9/11. They don't. Almost an equal number has written about the 1971 war. Beginning with Tariq Rahman, he and Adam Zamin Zad are possibly the only two in the 20th century, but in the 21st century, there have been lots of books about 1971 which have not received the same cognizance. And so it's important that it comes from here. The foreign academics obviously have a different kind of perspective.
Mm. Okay, Ashraf Jahangir Qazi, sir, please go ahead.
First, congratulations for a hugely stimulating conversation.
Thank you.
When we reached Delhi in 1997, the 50th anniversary for Pakistan and India, Salman Rushdie had come out with a volume about the best Indian writing during the 50 years of India, and actually included each one of the pieces he chose was written by Indians in English. There were none except for one, Saadat Hasan Mantoz, Toba Teg Singh. All the others he relegated to a class below the best of the English that he thought was available. And he did argue that the sensibility that was relevant to the broader region of South Asia and beyond the world itself was not to be found amongst regional literature. He was roundly condemned as being way off center, and he didn't know half the or most of the regional languages. How could he possibly make such a statement? Now, but one could see at the back of it, he thought Indian English had sort of melded more into the broad concourse of world literature than any regional literature in India. Do you find any similar development in Pakistan with regard to writing in English? Is it more embedded in what we see as emerging trends in world literature than is the far more established tradition of writing in Urdu, which, if it were similar, is it as insular, as relatively insular, as Salman Rushdie thought the indigenous languages were compared to writing in English?
Please, who do you want to answer this question?
I'm sure anybody could.
Anyone, okay. Well, in that case, anyone? Yes,
well, please. I don't think that writing in English is considered insular in any way, because...
Not the opposite.
Absolutely. I think what we have done and what we have proved, not that we needed to prove it, but we've set benchmarks for writing in English which are as good as it gets anywhere in the world. And when you get writers like Muhammad Hanif, and not so much with his Exploding Mangoes, because his that was the background for that was something quite sensational and so on. But if you look at his wonderful work on Alice Bhatti,
yeah,
and you look at the nuances that he talks about, I mean, he's talking about universal things. It doesn't matter if Alice Bhatti works in a hospital in Pakistan or wherever. These are all universal issues. When Taufik Rafat writes 16 poems for his younger brother, it's any man writing for his younger brother. So really, in that sense, language is really not a barrier at all. For that matter, I want to extend it a little further. I don't know why we have this issue about whether we write in English or whether we write in Urdu or whatever. The seminal writers that you have talked about, the 13 writers that you have taken up, they're all multilingual. They had no issue slipping from one language to the next. But there was an excellence benchmark in each of these languages. We're all multilingual, if you look at yourselves. We speak Punjabi at home, we speak English in our offices, we speak Urdu when we need to, we speak Hindko, whatever your mother language is. It's not an issue at all. Salman Rushdie was way off the mark when he made that, and he was roundly condemned for it. What we are talking about here is this is a language of choice by the people who know more than one language. I'm looking at a series of essays that Haris Khalik has written, which we're going to be talking about tomorrow. And he does a wonderful, wonderful analysis of exactly the issue that you're talking about. And I hope that you can attend that session, and then it'll sort of all come together. But my point is, it's not important what language is being used. What is important is what is the benchmark of excellence that is being achieved.
Right.
And I think for poets and for researchers like these two, for researchers like this young lady here, it's a non-issue whether you're writing in English or not.
And it's a matter of, you know, for example, getting to the wider readership.
Absolutely.
Yes, I was
so
about
I mean,
to
if you if you keep writing in Urdu, for example, keeping in
you
mind that you
yes.
know this is the only language in which we can express our culture, etc. So how will you sort of, you know,
right.
get to the global audience?
Right. Let me add over here. I mean, beginning with this has always happened. Pakistan is not the only country where this has happened. Of course, at the moment we know about the West Indies, we know about the Caribbean, we know about Africa, we know about India, etc. But then, look at that, all the six ahadiths, collections of ahadiths, were by Persians. And they were written in Arabic. Then you look at the Sabak-e-Hindi. The poetry in Persian, in India, was a very large, huge volume. Iqbal, of course, wrote, and that was in the 20th century. And Ghalib was proud of it. This is...
And Dr. all the Turkish poets.
Yes.
Nazım Hikmet and Ulhan Vali
absolutely.
And so on. They're contemporaries with Fez. And you can see the
absolutely.
Same sensibility there.
So there are several reasons. One of them, of course, is that is the language which is taught, learned, etc. Because these are the elite of that society. Secondly, because they reach a greater audience. I mean, I can speak Urdu and Punjabi, etc., but I can't write in any language other than English. It just so happens.
I'm sorry about it, but that's what it is. So when I wrote short stories, whatever they were worth, they were in English, good or bad, but they were, had to be in English. And I do my research thing, it is in English. I have no problem with it. It's a language, which it reaches, etc. It doesn't matter. So one does not have to be nationalistic in this. However, there is a point. The point is that when they are writing, they represent two aspects. One, the larger universal aspect which you talked about, fine. Yeah. The other one is they do get to the distinctive flavor, the identity of the people they are part of.
Yeah.
And they do both. And one can do that in any language.
Yeah.
If they do a good job in it, then that's the kind of literature one enjoys and one lauds, etc. If they don't do a good job, no matter which language it is, it's not literature.
Yeah.
No, in any case, when you use nationalistic things to say to somebody, you must write in this language because this is a colonial language or someone else's language, you are actually, if it's not the language that which is their the language that they can write in, they can express themselves in, you're actually rendering them into silence. You are actually saying that your voice is of no consequence, and that in itself. There's one other thing I'd like to point out, and which I hope I brought out in this book, is that over here we keep going on about English being the language of the elite, and Pakistani is using the language of the elite. But actually, because people of Pakistani origin, what Waqas says, you know, no matter where they live, there's a certain similarity, there's a kind of metaphor, there are references. Yeah. People who are living in Britain are not necessarily from the, and in any case, if you are a foreigner in Britain or elsewhere, you are on the margins. Mm. So there is a literature, what Pakistani English literature, it is not necessarily the language of a ruling class or an elite.
No.
It has got a much broader perspective, and in Britain particularly, you've got a strong working class literature emerging from Pakistani English writers.
And it is considered to be one of the voices in which Pakistan speaks.
Yeah,
and
yes,
there's an acceptability of that as too.
Yes, it is one of the voices. And now one of the, please do.
A slightly different view on this, and I do want to express it.
Please do.
Okay.
Because, you know, I've been actually campaigning a lot. I'm not again saying people should write in this language or not, but there is a more complex issue at stake here. When we talk about silencing people who can only write in English, and I take that point as legitimate, but we're also, by writing in English and privileging it, which also happens, by the way, silencing perhaps 90% of the population whose language is not English, who actually habitually speak other languages and write in other languages. So it's a very delicate balance to maintain. I'm not again saying that this is only an elitist language, but context becomes important.
Yes.
Where you have working class literature in England by Pakistani Britishers, they may serve the purpose we are talking of giving voice to the underprivileged, to the marginalized. In Pakistan, this does not happen, because if you write in English, you're already in a privileged position to be able to write in that language. So here, the other languages are actually competing to have that voice, to have that intervention in the establishment voice or in the literary voice that is privileged, so that they too can make a difference.
Okay.
Being sensitive to that, I think, is an important part. And most English writers, I would say, tend to be.
Yeah, but then there is also another way of sort of, you know, translating our regional literature into English so that, you know, and in order to see that whether or not this regional literature is in certain ways, you know, in dialogue with the, with the literature produced by internationally marketed writers.
Just one or two more questions from the audience. Questions from the audience? I see your hand. In fact, I see two. You raise your hand first, sir, please.
Thank you very much.
Please keep it closer and a little louder. Yes, thank you.
Is it on?
Yes, yes, fine.
Thank you very much. I mean, of course, thank you. How do you see the questions directed to
Muneeza Shamsie Sahiba? Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
How do you see, not in terms of the historical development, but in contemporary sense, how do you see Pakistani literature vis-a-vis other literatures that are being produced in the world at the moment? I mean, particularly in non-native speaking countries and societies like India, for instance, or African societies.
Okay. So the question is, how do you compare Pakistani literature in English with Indian literature in English?
Or
anywhere, I mean, wherever literature in English is being produced,
right.
And the society is non-native. I mean, contemporary in the last 15,
20 years. Well, you see, it's becoming very, very international, it's become very dynamic. And how it compares is by the fact that all these writers today, I mean, you can see it in the literary prizes, Pakistani writers are competing with everybody else. And Indian English writing became a sort of leading light much before Pakistani English literature came into its own. But today, they are all competing with each other. And they're actually also, they're not only competing, they're kind of interlinked. And the influence of one influences the other. Yes, I think it's in a very strong position, and you've also got, what is exciting is that you've got it in different genres. It's not, you know, earlier days it was, but now it's, you've got poetry, you've got drama, you've got, all the things that I've covered. You've, autobiography, what they call life writing, is the new thing. It's become very strong today. Autobiography is the other kind of writing that has come, and we're also kind of doing pretty well in that. So I think we'd compare very well to everybody else.
Right. Well, I'm afraid the time is up, so we'll have to finish. I have to thank the panelists very much, Khwaja Sahab, Muneeza Shamsie, Navid Sahiba, Aroosa Sahiba, all of you, thank you very much indeed, and of course the audience which made the day for us. So thanks very much. And here is the book again. You may buy it, get her to sign it, and you can recommend it to all those who don't read literature. Once they read this book, I hope they start reading literature. Thanks very much.
Thank you for attending the session. Copies of Hybrid Tapestries is available outside the hall, please. You can purchase your copy right outside the hall.